So, I'm sure I'm not good. I can hear myself. How's everyone doing? Good? Now I'll leave it to you how you want me to go ahead with this small interaction that we have with us, because you know, I could run with the presentation, but I'm not sure if you get you what you really want. So, you know, you could ask questions and I'll jump to my slide wherever it's relevant, or I could just go ahead and do whatever you want. So let me first introduce myself and what you guys do, and then let's hear what your answers are. So, IdeaForge makes unmanned aerial vehicles, and one of the most easy and most memorable memory of our company in public mind is that our first and a very early prototype of ours was featured in the movie Three Idiots. So you see Aamir Khan flying that small helicopter. That was my co-founder Ashish actually flying the system, and Aamir Khan was pretending to hold the dummy remote. He was quite angry though, I thought. He wanted the real thing. You want to go out, like, you can't do that. Anyways. So that's us, and that prototype from where you saw it is currently one of the most widely deployed micro unmanned aerial vehicle in the country right now. We are deployed for counterinsurgency, anti-terror activities, for border monitoring, for traffic monitoring, ground management, for real estate photography, pipeline monitoring. I mean, you can imagine it's basically a camera that you can place anywhere you feel like placing it in the three dimensions. Just place it anywhere, have it look at whatever you want to look at without any real restrictions as such. And you don't even have to fly it. It will fly on its own. It's a completely autonomous system, and you just have to give it GPS locations, tell it how high it needs to fly, and control the camera. And that's about it. That's basically what we do. I can show you a video as well if that helps. How many of you had already heard about this? So, do I need to run a video, or would that be a waste of time? Should I? For the people who haven't seen it, let me run a video. So this, you'll see the IIT road, main road, right? In front of IIT. It's about 2 kilometers from the UAV right now. This is some crowd monitoring activity in Chandigarh. It was a political rally that we were called to cover. It's some mock operation we were doing for one of our clients. Your targets or suspects or whatever it is that you want to look at. So yeah, so this is what we guys do, and this, yeah. So now tell me, what do you want to do? Go ahead. My first year at IDMobi, let me start even before that. So, you know, it's I think important to understand, and important to understand one's own self a lot more as compared to, you know, how much thought you would have usually given. A lot of our world is typically very externally oriented in general, and we measure a lot of our success, our path and things we do when we look at people around us and what they are doing. But I think entrepreneurship is a journey where the more you know yourself, that much more bandwidth you give yourself to be able to pull through some of the most challenging times that you may face during your journey. And therefore, it's very important to understand where you're coming from for your own self, one needs to understand that. And my journey was very interesting in that case that I was a nut job when I was a kid. Basically, my uncle used to think that pagal to nahi ho gaya, main ek choti si jagah pe aise gol gol ghumta raha. And I, frankly, the first memory I have of myself as a kid is me doing these rounds and cooking up some random stories about whatever came to my mind. And most of the times, it surprised me, and it's a pattern I observed much later when I grew up a little bit, that it never fascinated me that the he, you know, at that time when I was a kid, He-Man used to run on the TV. So, you know, my, obviously as a kid, my stories used to be around He-Man as well. And after about 15 minutes of getting into my story, right, I would completely forgot about who He-Man was and how good his body was. My only thought was about his sword and how it could be better than what it is today. Or what is shown on the TV. And I would keep thinking about ways and means to make it better. And I mean, even at that time, and this I'm talking about, maybe my first memories of myself are around when I was in my second standard or first standard or something. That's the time that we used to play. So yeah, so I used to keep doing this daydreaming, and when you've done daydreaming for so long, suddenly, you know, a lot of frustration starts building up, because it was daydreaming earlier, looking at these cartoon characters, but slowly and slowly it evolved. I started thinking about technology, started thinking about how to make IC engines better or to do whatever better, but basically I had no resources and I had no clue also that something like this could be done or, you know, whatever it is. So once I overheard my dad talking to, I think I was in my 10th standard at that time, I overheard my dad, the IITs are the best place to study engineering in the country, and I figured out by then that engineering is what I need to do if I want to make some of these things come into real life. So yeah, so that was my motivation, and I was fortunate enough to also get through, and I joined IIT Bombay. I did my dual degree in mechanical engineering, that course we have at CADA, computer aided design and automation. So I did my 5-year dual degree course here, and after about 6 months of coming into IIT, I realized that I came here for a reason. My entire motivation to come to IIT was because I had this real big bag of ideas that I wanted to sort of implement when I came here. And that sort of, I started pushing myself and started doing implementations around some of the things. I think we were also fortunate that by then Yantriki, one of these robotic competitions, had already taken a lot of, picked up a lot of steam in IIT, and almost everybody around me wanted to participate in Yantriki. So I think first year, the first bot that I made was a Yantriki competing robot. So it was a pretty lame thing, but we were quite happy that it actually worked and was able to do its job. It grew within its couple of first trials in the water, but it was a water pool competition that we were part of. So this was my first year, and from the very beginning I had started sort of executing some of these things that I had in my mind. In my second year, I remember I participated in a competition called Open Hardware, and I made this device that could, and this I'm talking about in 2001, yeah, in 2001. So made this device where if a vehicle is moving on the road, just by the fact that it is moving on the road, and they need not any pump or anything, but just that a vehicle is passing over a device, it will start generating energy. And so that was something I had done. And in that year, Abdul Kalam was one of the chief invitees for that tech fest, and I have a pic with him. That really did not fascinate me as much as actually seeing my device work fascinated me more. And so that was it. Let me jump to some of the things that we've done. So that was the beginning. After that, energy device. So I've always been an energy person. Every year I used to think of a new problem to solve. The way this first problem came to me, that energy generating device, was also very interesting. I was actually going back home. I am from Jodhpur in Rajasthan. I was going back home, and once you, if you're taking the western line, if you just about when you cross Mumbai, there is this big bridge that comes, and so everything was quiet in the train till the time I reached that bridge. And suddenly, when I reached that bridge, there was a lot of vibration, and I could hear a lot of sound. And suddenly, I was like woken up from my thoughts and whatever it was, and I suddenly recognized that there is too much sound here. If there is too much sound, that somehow, you know, that chain of thought started building. If बहुत ज़्यादा sound है, तो मतलब बहुत ज़्यादा energy waste हो रही है. बहुत ज़्यादा energy waste हो रही है, तो इस ground पे क्यों नहीं दिखती है? Ground पे इतनी आवाज़ कम क्यों आती है? Then I started thinking about it, and I realized that when you are on ground, there is a lot of vibration absorption that's happening in the earth, and ये वो. तो क्योंकि फालतू का सोचने की आदत थी, तो खूब सारा फालतू सोचा उसके ऊपर. तो सोचने की वजह से finally that device came up, and we made that. And then after I made that, I came up with another idea of a spring that would help me store a lot of energy in the form of mechanical energy. Random. So the idea was that we guys keep doing a lot of random movements. Not all of our motions are also as efficient as they ideally should be. So could I leverage that and create more energy out of it? So that happened, and then whatever I developed on that, I filed a patent on that and all that. And very interesting thing, what also happened was that I never really had the money to implement any of these ideas, right? मतलब बहुत मुश्किल होती थी मेरे लिए पैसा spend करना खुद भी अपने लिए भी. तो projects के लिए तो definitely there was no money at all. What I realized was that if I have to do all of this, I need to get some capital from somewhere. And I remember going to one of our faculties and asking him that I have this idea and I want some $1,500 to implement it. And I mean, by God's grace, he actually gave me that money. And I went ahead, I made my prototype, I showed it to him excitedly. He says, see, this is what I've made, and you know, it works, and it's actually generating energy and all of that. So that encouraged him, but not enough. And next time I went with to ask for more money, he said that, you know, not me, somebody else. I went to somebody else. Then he also agreed. This time I raised about 15,000 rupees to make a prototype. I was successful in implementing that as well, so I was quite happy. So success doesn't mean that, you know, the product or what you're creating has to be actually successful. Successful means that you literally did some hard work and created something, even if it failed as miserably as I thought something about. So that's how I started actually implementing these ideas. I didn't have money, and I went, and so I just want to highlight that you are at a very, very fortunate place, that here in IIT Bombay, if you go to people, they will not discourage you. They will actually encourage you to the extent that I am already talking to you about. And this I am talking about way back in 2000, 2001, 2002. And in my, so in my third attempt to try and raise more capital for some of my projects, I met Professor Ramana. I'm not sure if a lot of you have all of you heard about Professor Ramana? I'm sure, right? Yeah. So that's when I met him, and at that time, Professor Amarnath was trying to promote a cell in IIT Bombay called Innovation Cell. It was at that time called Mashwala Innovation Cell. And I hope, or I'm sure, it's still called the same. So the idea of the Innovation Cell was exactly this, that a student, if he has any crazy idea, the Innovation Cell will try and arrange funding for that idea, and you just have to do a project report and submit it. So this particular image that I'm showing you is basically what I convinced sir to give us about 7-8,000 bucks on, so that we could make a bigger prototype fit. So these are the kind of crude implementations sort of that helped us convince them that there is an idea. This is a mock-up, and you know, if you do this, something will happen. So if you see that roller here, you fit that roller into that big wheel that you have there, and basically the roller is rolling and the wheel will flip when the roller reaches the end of the track. You will have the next lot of the track in front of you to move or something like that. So these are the kind of random ideas that I used to cover around at that time. So we made this. These were well and good because it was my hand that was pushing the roller and all of that. When I actually implemented it on a slightly bigger wheel, one of the funniest things that ever happened to me happened in that time. So imagine this track built of, you know, this track. This is basically a solid track. So this solid track is built of aluminum. There are a couple of, you know, ribs there and all of that. And there is this rolling wheel inside it, and it's trying to roll ahead. Now, you know, these all worked really well when we were doing our simulations. We went ahead and invested in that thing, and I spent sleepless nights in trying to get it all in shape, and you know, I handcrafted whatever that prototype was. And I start the motor, and the damn wheel keeps rolling inside the track only. The entire small wheel just kept rolling inside the track. I was like, what the hell is going on over here? It's supposed to flip. It's not flipping. What's wrong with it? So, you know, even that was good enough. I'm saying that. You know, failing as much as that, or, you know, just being able to create something and learning from it was good enough. And I think that's one of the most important parts of the exploration that you're doing right now in IIT. I mean, it's, frankly speaking, nothing starts at a business plan. And I'm really glad that Vishnu, when you mentioned that, you were focused and passionate about technology, because that's ultimately the enabler, right? I mean, it doesn't matter how great a business plan that you have, if you don't have a core technology that somebody is willing to support or fund, nothing's going to really get built, right? I mean, because technology is what is going to ultimately give you that advantage. And there are, apart from technology, there are several other ways of building advantages, but you're in IIT, I mean, ultimately we are here to create technology and then use that technology to solve some problems. So, you know, I would really love if people do that. And it was, I just want to also say that it was not just me who was doing all of this stuff. My colleague Ashish Bhatt, Rahul Singh, Amarbi, almost all of us who are from IIT Bombay and our team, we used to basically do this. You know, we used to eat, drink, and sleep technology. Ashish, how many of you have heard of this competition called MicroMouse? So MicroMouse, back, you know, it started in IIT Bombay in 2002, and at that time Ashish, my colleague, one of our co-founders, he was in his first year. And he had the audacity to actually attempt MicroMouse as a competition. MicroMouse is a fully autonomous robotics competition where you just leave a mouse in a maze, and that mouse has to solve the maze and then run to the center the fastest. So it was an AI competition, and he had the cheek to actually attempt it in his first year. And by far and large, he was the only one who actually had something running in that entire competition. And that was his first year, and since then, the next 4 or 5 years, he literally built machines which were better and better and pretty much competitive at even the global level in this competition. So it's basically a lot of passion of technology that drove us to what we're doing today. And what is also very interesting is that a lot of these competitions that keep happening in IIT, So we used to be crazy and we used to participate in a lot of those as well. I'm sure a lot of you have heard about Robocon. I'm not sure if IIT Bombay participates in it anymore or not. Does IIT Bombay participate in Robocon? No, right? But back in 2003 is when we first started Robocon, and in 2005 finally we went and represented India in this competition. This is 2004, this is 2003 machine that went from IIT Bombay. This was me and a bunch of other guys, and this is the 2004 machines. And because we had done so much technology when we were students, and we had implemented not just, you know, participated in not just competitions, but we had also implemented our own ideas. We were actually fairly good at it by the time we were graduating from IIT. And one of the examples I give you is of this competition in 2004. So by 2004, this was the first year. So the first year we made a machine in Robocon was basically a mechanically autonomous machine. So it did not have essentially an iota of electronics in it. It basically had a couple of limit switches, and that was the only electronics it had, and we were still able to make an autonomous machine on that. It's crazy how we managed it, but the way we solved the problem actually made it possible. But the second year, it was not possible to do any of that jugglery, and I didn't know Ashish by then. The next year, for this competition, to be able to build a team and build a robot, we needed electronics, and somebody told us that Ashish is really good at it and he participates in MicroMouse and all of that. That's when I first met Ashish. And that year when we went to the competition, I'll show you the stark difference that we had in technology as compared to, and that's mostly because we just spent a lot of time doing it. And that was really helpful for us. So our entire autonomous robotics electronics was this big. This was the total size of our electronics, you know, this board. Maybe smaller, half the size of this surface tablet you have. And everybody else had electronics this big and stacked three high. That was their robot, autonomous robotics. And we were left wondering on day one, chal gaya hai. Hum logon ne kuch galat kiya hai, did we miss some components or something like that? But we actually had not missed anything at all. We were the only guys capable in that competition to solve the problem that was presented in front of us. We actually did it in the trial. We moved up on something in the finals, which is your Murphy's Law playing its cruel hand in the end, which it usually does. How many of you have actually done a lot of robotics in IIT or any hardware implementation in IIT? Or even programming? I mean, why not this? Why just hardware? How many? You guys seem to doubt that you've done anything. You have? Good, so I'm sure you know that Murphy's Law plays a very important role in technology development. Have you heard of it? How many of you have heard of Murphy's Law? Seriously, people have not experienced Murphy's Law so far. How many of you have had things go bad at the last moment at the worst possible time? I can see that majority of you have experienced Murphy's Law. It's a law that is very difficult to escape. So that's what happens. And so I'm just saying that if you keep at it, if you keep doing something, you will get good at it. And if you are good at it, eventually your confidence will rise to a level where by the time you're graduating, by the time you're leaving this place, you will be brazen enough to say that you will be able to do something. What is very important is to be confident that you will be able to take up a task, a responsibility, like being an entrepreneur, a responsibility of taking an idea and creating a business out of it. It's a big responsibility, and if you don't have the confidence, it's not going to help you at all. So if you keep doing something, a lot of times it will help you build that confidence, and it will help you take those decisions, because you will not be insecure about everything. At least you will be secure about the fact that you can do technology. If you can do technology, then there will be people like mentors we mentioned, Sign is there, there are other people, other seniors of yours who will be possibly be able to help you out and mentor you. But if you don't, and not even confident of your ability to execute technology, then you may start feeling that it's not worth it at the very first time you start facing a problem in your entrepreneurial journey. So this is what we guys did. I mean, made random stuff. This is the first prototype of our quad rotor that we ever built. Unfortunately, made of carbon steel propellers, which scared the shit out of us when it failed. And for about a year, we sort of completely grounded the project. We got so scared. And then we went on to make another one, and then subsequently another one, and another one, and another one, and another one. So that's our IT, not just mine. My entire team has basically spent their time in IT, and at that time, I remember in 2000, between this period of 2000 to 2003-04, there were very few people in IIT who actually loved technology. I mean, it was so difficult to find people who loved technology. When I met my co-founders Ashish and Rahul, I was literally like, we had formed an oasis around us, that you know, ab isse dur nahi jana. And that's the team that we formed, and that team still continues to create technology and deliver products that are currently one of the class leading products in their space globally, not just in the country. So I think some of the takeaways are that you really need to have an amazing team, you need to have passion for what you're doing, and you need to do it enough number of times. And IIT is the time when you have all the time to do that. You have all the time to fail, all the time to make mistakes, because in real world that time will shrink. The penalty that you will get for failing in the real world is going to be much higher than what you will get over here if you attempt doing things and start doing things over here. So what next? I've given a very long-minded answer to what you would ask for, but what next? What do you want to ask me next? What question does it pop in your head? Yeah, go ahead.
So I have an idea, but I don't have how will I create this idea into a product. So this is pretty normal at this beginning, right?
Yes, of course.
So what next should I do? I have an idea. I don't have a vision. And I know it's a need for second, I don't have the complete expertise that will be required. At some point of time, my expertise will fall short. So I cannot do
So the question he's asking is that he has an idea. He doesn't know whether his skills will be adequate at a later point in time. Today you find that your skills are adequate to start it at least. And he's not sure whether, you know, what should be the starting point, how should you even go about making the product. Is that question something that resonates with everybody? Do you have those questions in your mind that you have an idea about what next, right? So the way I used to think about it is that I have an idea, right? And I don't know whether it's true or not, but typically, and even before an idea, right, a lot of times you actually get a problem first. And once you identify a problem you want to solve, at least for me, it happens that it typically comes with its own vision of what the solution should be like, right? You think ki yaar ye chair jo hai ye bahut hi close hai table ke, you know. When I sat on this chair, I found that this chair was too close to the table. I couldn't get my knee in. I'm unfortunately a bit tall for this chair, but and I felt that, you know, immediately the moment I thought we could there be an adjustable chair that, you know, every time I sit on it, I can actually just push it back and get inside comfortably and then get it back to something like this. So I'm just saying that there is a problem, a daily life problem or a problem you've seen somewhere or something that touched your heart. And a lot of times it also comes with that quick flash of a solution. And that solution is something that is your first intuitive feeling that, you know, it's something that can be solved. And if you have that kind of a solution or an idea in mind, I think the next thing is to think